we are going to talk about a documentary that Brad and I watched. A couple weeks ago, we discussed documentaries that we need to see, that we're hoping either to make or to have made, so that we can enjoy them and so that we can have that information from behind the scenes. But in the process of saying, you know what I want to watch, we came up with some ideas and then did some research and found out they already exist, which was really cool.
Yep.
One of them was Brad and I were talking and we thought, wouldn't it be cool if they did a documentary like Fastball, but about knuckleball? Knuckleball as a pitch, the knuckleballers that throw them, etc. Turns out there is a documentary called Knuckleball, and it was, what is it, 2012?
Yeah, 2012.
Released 2012. It was, Brad and I both watched it today. I watched it today. Did you watch it today?
Yeah, I watched it this morning.
Me too. And it was awesome.
It was really good.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
I loved it.
I liked it.
It highlighted specifically two players, R.A. Dickey and Tim Wakefield. And I thought they did a great job. Brad was really excited about how they framed it up. Brad, why don't you tell us what you loved most about it?
Well, so it's R.A. Dickey and Tim Wakefield, first off, are the last two guys to throw knuckleballs. And this, like we said, this was released in 2012. And the bulk of the story is from 2011.
Yeah.
And one thing I thought was really interesting about the way that it was framed up was like, oh, you know, like the perception of the knuckleball and the knuckleballer, that it's like basically like a circus pitch, right? And yeah, that the guys who throw the knuckleballs are kind of like gimmicky pitchers, and they can't actually pitch, so they have to throw the knuckleball, right? Which is the same thing you say about a submarine or a sidearm pitch or whatever. It's the same thing.
Yeah.
But they say that about the knuckleball. And as I'm sitting here watching, I'm like, well, the thing that they're not saying about either of these guys yet is that Tim Wakefield was a failed infielder because he couldn't hit, right?
Yeah, first base.
And then, first baseman. And then R.A. Dickey is like, he used to be like I don't want to say like a legitimate pitcher, but he was like a
traditional fastball pitcher.
A traditional pitcher, yeah.
Yeah.
And so, but they did eventually get into that, and they actually got into both of those things in depth, which I thought was great because it's part of the story that has to be told. There were certain things that were left out, particularly with R.A. Dickey's story, was that they went early with the victim card, right? They tried to paint Dickey as the sympathetic character, that like, oh, he went around from team to team and was never sure where he was going to be from day to day. It's like, no, he pitched like 32 games for the Mariners in 2008, you know? And yeah, he hopped around, but that's because he was a knuckleballer who was trying to find his spot in the league, which he did in New York with the Mets.
Yep.
And it's just, it's too bad for him that they only did the documentary for 2011 going into the 2012 season, because he won the Cy Young in the 2012 season.
Yeah.
Right. Like that was like, it got to the end and I was kind of like, oh, but just go over the top.
Just missed it. Just a bit outside.
It would have been the cherry. Right.
It
I wonder
been
the documentarians, if they're like, if we had waited 6 months to release this or whatever, you know, we could have got the Cy Young in there, but it is what it is.
Yeah. I thought there's a deadline for everything. I thought it was great. I didn't like the victim card that they played. I didn't even like R.A. Dickey's delivery of everything. It seemed like he was playing the humble card a little hard, but maybe that's just genuinely who he is. I don't know.
That's what I say. He does seem like that's who he is, though, because he seems very soft-spoken.
Yeah.
And like a genuinely kind person. So he might just be that humble person that like, oh, you know, I finally got my shots. Like, well, dude, you played for like four teams already, you know?
Yeah.
But
well,
I don't know.
Anyway, it felt like it dovetailed a little too conveniently. It felt like it was somewhat play acted, and I don't know if that's true. That's how it came off a little bit. On top of that, I also, they tried really hard to say, holy crap, this will never go away, right? Somebody is going to always come and throw the knuckleball. Somebody's always going to be there. And it just depends on whether clubs are going to be able to take the chance on them. And at one point there was a quote was it by Tito? I think it was Terry Francona that said, if the manager will just sit on his hands and be okay with whatever happens, then you could really see some genuine magic. But that's
yeah, what I think it was him. Yeah, because he even said there's going to be some off pitches, there's going to be some stolen bases, but yep. That's just what comes with it.
Yeah, he was speaking specifically of Tim Wakefield and the kind of up and down roller coaster ride that they had. Tim Wakefield pitched for 17 years. Was it 17 years in Boston?
Yeah.
Out of his 18 or 19 total seasons or something like that? Out of his
19 total, yeah.
Yeah.
So, you know, you talk about how they said that they made it seem like there's always going to be a knuckleballer. And I think that what, like, I guess, I don't know if we're like jumping to the end here, but the knuckleball is basically extinct in Major League Baseball. Like, that's one of the reasons I wanted to watch this, because I thought it was really interesting. There are no knuckleballers in Major League Baseball right now. No legitimate knuckleballers.
There's no, right? Like, no everyday regular rotation knuckleball.
Like R.A. Dickey said, every position player on the Mets threw a knuckleball.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. They all wanted to show him.
Yeah. Yeah. They all wanted him to come over, look at his knuckleball, and for him to say, hey, and they'd always ask, like, hey, like, how's my knuckleball? He's like, they all kind of make fun of it. It's kind of a gimmick, whatever, but. You know, but anyway,
they didn't win the Cy Young with it.
They didn't. That's right. And nobody else did. But I think that the reason we don't see the knuckleballer, despite everybody being able to being quote unquote, being able to throw one.
Right.
Is because of what Terry Francona said. There's going to be pass balls. There's going to be stolen bases because nobody's willing to give up an extra base in the name of a pitch that's hard to hit.
Yeah.
They would rather have a 102 mile an hour fastball that's hard to hit than a 65 mile an hour knuckleball. It's hard to hit, but also hard to catch.
Super hard to catch. At one point, there was a catcher. I think, was it Phil Niekro's catcher or was it Charlie Huff's catcher? One of the two had their catcher out and he was showing two different catcher's mitts. One of them was a traditional, like narrow little small pocket. And then another one was this big, two or three times as big, freaking like it was as big as a base. It's what it looked like.
It's huge.
It was huge.
I think it was Phil Niekro.
The one I use for the knuckleballs.
Yeah, and that's so as a catcher, I hated knuckleballs. And like I said, there's always like I think I've brought this up before. There were guys I played with in high school, like my knuckleball's my out pitch. I'm like, no, it's not. Right. And part of that is because it's gonna end up at the backstop and the guy's gonna end up first base.
Yeah,
like that's not how we're going to play this. But one thing that used to drive me crazy is that who was it? One of the guys, was it Wakefield, said that his dad would go out and play catch with him. He'd throw the knuckleball just to get him to tire out.
Yeah.
I'd go out and play catch with my dad, and he always thought it was funny to just randomly throw me one. And I'd get so mad. Because it would just like hit off the heel of my glove. I'm like, what are you doing? Because my dad threw a wicked knuckleball. Gets so mad. He's like, if you can catch that, you can catch anything. Like, yeah, you're right. It's true.
That's a true story.
And I think it made me better because he would throw him at the park too when we were playing when I was taking batting practice. He'd randomly whip a knuckleball up there at me.
That's awesome. That's good training.
It worked out.
It's interesting though that you say that about your dad because one of the points they made in the documentary was that it doesn't hurt your arm, right? It doesn't hurt your arm at all. In fact, less is more. So there's no longevity issues. There's no Tommy John problems. There's no shoulder issues. None of that comes into play because it's all about finesse. It's all about the push. It's all about the finger placement and the grip has to be just right. But it's not a hard pitch. It's a finesse pitch. And so everything that happens from the time until it leaves your hand has to be dialed just right. And then it's in God's hands. It's kind of what they said.
Yeah. Like, well, so like you watch it. So they show slow motion of the release so many times throughout the entire documentary. And every single time it's so delicate. Every one of them just so delicate that just, like,
and the you cannot just put, kind of flies off there.
That you cannot put any rotation on that ball or else it's not going to knuckle. And it's just going to be BP, like they said, which I thought was really cool that they understand the delicacy of that because I was at a baseball camp one time growing up and there was a pitcher. He was in the Red Sox organization. He was a knuckleballer. He went to Fresno State and he's thrown the knuckleball there. And the first time he pitched in, I want to say it was in Utah. The first time he pitched in Utah, the coach was like, so what happened to it? He's like, it went a long ways because the air is not thick enough in Utah for that ball to knuckle. So it just floated right in there and they crushed it.
Because it is all about turbulence, basically, right? It's all about the air grabbing it and moving it around, pushing it around. And because it's not slicing and dicing through the air, it just gets bumped around. It's basically what happens. There's just natural friction that tosses it around. You know, I got to change gears a little bit because one of the things I thought was so cool is that they paid homage to this fraternity of these four people. There are four people that they could literally gather to talk. When we watched Fastball, they had a lineup of dudes. They had hitters, they had pitchers, they had every generation you could think of. It was all this like super cool, like nostalgia or whatever.
Rock stars, every single one of them.
Total rock stars. In this one, there were four dudes. They had Tim Wakefield, R.A. Dickey, Charlie Huff, and Phil Niekro. That was it. Those are the only four dudes they could find to talk about this pitch at that level of success. And I loved that, man. And so it was cool because Dickey said, oh, I just watched Tim. I just had to figure out what Tim was doing. But Tim said, man, the day Phil Niekro came to talk to me about this changed my whole life. And now we're good friends. And I go to him when I have problems or whatever. It's like, who else do you go to? You can't go to anybody else.
Yeah, exactly. Well, and there's the clip. So there's one section where R.A. Dickey, I believe, goes to Charlie Huff.
Yeah.
Right? They go to like it looked like a high school locker room.
Yeah.
They sat down.
No, that was Niekro. I think it was Phil Niekro. Well, maybe it was Charlie Huff. I don't remember.
I think it was, no, I think you're right. I think it was Phil Niekro. Anyway, it was one of the old guys. Yeah. And they're sitting there watching film. And he tells Dickey, he says, you need to change speeds on it more, because R.A. Dickey was known for throwing an 80 mile an hour knuckleball.
Right.
And the thing is that, I mean, first off, we're watching those games and we're watching it go in. And I remember as a kid, just watching him be like, just crush the ball that the old man is throwing. Like, how hard can it be? You know, I can get in the box and crush that ball. So there's that. But then it's like, you get big leaguers who 80 miles an hour is a little bit closer to what they're used to.
Yeah.
Right. Break or no break.
Yeah.
So then if he starts mixing up speeds on it, though, that's when it gets to be really challenging. I think at one point they said that he was throwing 55 miles an hour to 80 miles an hour.
Yeah.
And that was really what took him over the top to win the Cy Young.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, so what's interesting is they said that you can go a long way in baseball throwing a knuckleball. And just to give you a frame of reference, Phil Niekro made his debut in 64, but it looks like he only played 10 games. So let's call it 65, 41 ball games in 65. That was his age 26 year. Okay. Mm-hmm. The last recorded game he appeared in was 1947. He was 48 years old.
Yeah.
That's insane. That's insane.
He looked like an old man out there. You saw
he looked like an old man.
He looked like he was like 60.
Bro, he had white hair coming out and everything.
Yeah.
It was insane. It was so cool. Because he did look like old man River out there on the mound.
And I wonder if, and I don't know if he retired because he couldn't handle the travel anymore. It's like if he could get on like a home games only schedule, you know, like an old coach or something like that. But
yeah. Well, he went in 1987, he started with, looks like he was a free agent, and then he got traded, and then he went to Cleveland, then he went to Toronto, and then he finished in Atlanta. And that last stint in Atlanta with one game was a 15.0 ERA. 15.00 with three innings. So that's not good. That's not good at all. No, six hits, not. Five runs.
Yeah.
He earned every one of them. So it looks like maybe they took him out a bunch. Anyway, point of the story is it was a terrific documentary. Loved everything about it. Pretty much. I mean, there were some things that we've mentioned, but it was, did you have anything else you wanted to say about it, Brad?
No, I don't know. I mean, It was an entertaining watch. It kept me engaged the entire time. I always wanted to see what they were going to say next about it. It was really cool to see that, like you said, that fraternity of knuckleballers. I did like the story about Charlie Huff when he signed his big league contract. The general manager comes to his house. His dad comes out of the coal mine, you know, and he says, $250. He's like, well, I don't have $250 to give you for my son to come play baseball. Like, No. We'll give him the money. We're going to give him $250 to come play for us.
A month. It must have blown his
mind. Not just one time.
Every month.
With a $2 a day meal allowance. It's like, oh, that's man, right. That's crazy.
That's so cool. I love that.
I'm sure that moment must have just been like making it as a kid from the coal mines. But anyway, great documentary. I would actually like to see, like, along the lines of the pitches. It did get me thinking that, like, I would like to see something about curveball. Like,
me too.
Because that's the first breaking pitch you see. You learn how to throw as a little leaguer, right?
Yes.
Stay away from the slider for obvious reasons. But totally. Curveball, and then maybe slider. The devastation that it has wrought on Major League Baseball and the elbows of pitchers would be really interesting.
Be fascinating.
Changeup might be interesting for guys who have to adjust their pitching style. Like, go through with each individual pitch and see how it affects the game, because everything is so effective that you could tell a story about it. I think
you totally could
just get all of it.
Well, and just like every storyline in baseball, it's all about the people involved, right? And this documentary did that perfectly. It told the stories of these two knuckleballers that went up and down in their careers and all the things that happened just over the course of one season, right? We followed these guys for 2011. We got a little flashback, got a little flash forward, but ultimately we watched 2011 happen for R.A. Dickey and Tim Wakefield. And it was excellent storytelling, right? Honestly. Mm-hmm. So I did a little bit of research, and it turns out that none other than the Baltimore Orioles, just to be sure, last year debuted a 33-year-old knuckleballer.
Oh, really? Where's he at now?
His name was Mickey Janis. I don't know where he is now, but he's a 3-year-old knuckleballer, made his debut. He was picked 44th round of the 2010 draft by the Rays, and then adopted the knuckleball when Tampa Bay cut him after his second professional season. He spent 3 years in independent baseball before the Mets signed him in 2015, picked up by the Orioles in 2020, waited out the canceled season, and then pitched well enough to go to AAA in a call-up. So, and this is from SI.com.
So he appeared in one game last year.
Oh, you got it. Yeah.
Yep. One game, 3 1/3 against the, let's see here, against the Astros. So not exactly the team you want to be brought in, because he 3 1/3, 8 hits, 1 strikeout, 4 walks, and 7 earned.
Ooh. So
not necessarily put in a position to succeed, though.
No, not at all. But that is how rare we are. I mean, that's the rarity of the pitch right now, honestly. So,
yep.
Anyway,
yeah,
it is available online. We got it for free on YouTube. Actually, the full 90-minute documentary is available free on YouTube. We'll go ahead.
The link is in the description.
In the description. Yep. We'll make sure it's there for you so that you can watch it, because it is worth 90 minutes of your time. Absolutely. And I even had to watch it in snippets. I wasn't able to watch it all the way through, and I didn't feel like that I lost anything in that. So, yeah. I think that's a hallmark of good storytelling. Yeah.
Yep.
Anyway, baseball family, let us know what documentaries you want to see. If you've seen Knuckleball, with an exclamation point, by the way, that's important. If you've seen Knuckleball, let us know what you thought of it. Do you miss Tim Wakefield? I called my friend Mike Farns and I asked him, I said, "What? Tell me about Tim Wakefield." Big Boston Red Sox fan. He says he loves Timmy, loves everything about him. I said, oh, okay, cool. So we had a good conversation about what it was like to be a Red Sox fan through all 17 of those years, and what it was like to have all those ups and downs and all that stuff. And now he's left with, as the way things go, you end on a high note, and you're left with wonderful memories and praise for the rest of your life. So anyway, it's super cool to have that conversation, and we want to know if we'll ever see a knuckleball again. So jump in the comments or in the mailbag and let us know what you think.